Hey, look, guys, I'm Sam Roberson. I'd like to welcome y'all today. Thanks for coming, guys. There's a whole lot more of you showed up than I thought, you know, and I appreciate that. I really do, because this is something that's been long going and been trying to get kicked off, trying to get started. But just again, thank you for coming. And I don't know if you've been watching the video up here or not, but it's just kind of some little rolling slides of some different guys that have been fishing with me. And hey, it's feeling that thump. That's what it's all about. Look, before we get started though, you don't mind, let's have a word of prayer and just open up with that. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you again for this day. Thank you, Jesus, for the privilege of coming out. Thank you, Jesus, for loving us and caring for us. Thank you for watching over and guiding us. Lord, we just pray and thank you for each one that's here represented today. Go with us, lead us, and guide and direct us. In your name we pray. Hey, look, amen. Just a little background from who I am and how this all got started. My notes. Hey, look. Hey, look, I won't keep you long. Wrong book. That's our men's group, Jeff.
That's a good book.
Anyway, it's been a long, hard battle, a long road all the way through. But, you know, I've been doing this probably for 50 plus years. And you may think that I'm really not that old, but, you know, we don't seem like it. You know, I don't know how old most of you guys are, but the Lord give us a spirit. And that spirit doesn't get tired. What gets tired is body. I fished, like my buddy over there said when he retired, Pete told me, he said, you know, he said, six Saturdays and one Sunday. And that's what we try to live by, six Saturdays and one Sunday. But I didn't get to fish for 4 days last week. But hey, it's hard. But
I sure
how to make six. It's tough. Somebody's got to do it. You know, and hey, I tell Charles all the time, where he's all the time agitating me. Charles Johnson, that guy sitting right here in the front, he's always agitating me about white perch fishing. He needs to retire, is all I've told him. But anyway, hey, I've been doing this probably for 50 years, though, and started a long time ago. 50 years is a long time, but 50 years ago, it really has been 51 this coming year. 50 years when I started thinking about doing all this. There was two things I fell in love with. One, sitting back there in that black shirt like I got on. And the other is Darbon Lake. You know, 50 years ago on one of our first dates, I carried her to Darbon. So we rode up. Darbon was just getting flooded, just getting filled up. We went to Downsville side. I think she let me kiss her. I'm not real sure about that. I won't go there. But anyway, we went to the Downsville side, and I looked out across that lake, and I said, man, this is just something. I turned around and looked at her and I said, oh, that's something too. So here we are 50 years later and I'm doing this kind of thing and we're trying to get it started. But guys, I know every one of you are here. You love the white perch fish. If you didn't, you wouldn't be here. You know, and that's something that you can't give up. You can't explain it to somebody. If they don't know about white perch fishing or have ever white perch fished, you just can't explain to them what that thump's all about, and that's what we're here for. But I started out as a young guy. You probably watched up there on that screen a while ago as they were rolling through. There was two, I'll call them older guys. One of them was holding fish. That was her daddy. The other one was in a Marine outfit. That was my daddy. And, you know, excuse me. I'm not a speaker either. But between the two, you know, growing up, and through that, I learned how to white perch fish. I learned how to love the Lord. I learned how to love my wife. And that's what it's all about. And we talk about white perch fishing and her daddy. 50 years ago, when the first time I ever went with him, he carried me out to Sheeny Lake. If any of you know about Sheeny Lake, that's a tough lake to fish. And I was in a little boat paddling along there, and he was trying to tell me to keep up. He wouldn't let me get in his boat. That was a no-no to start with. But he would let me go out there, and he would let me watch occasionally. But he would spider rig. Now, you think spider rigging's been around a while? It has. He did this with cane poles in Sheeny Lake. And boy, I'm telling you, that was a tough lake to try to do something like that in. But he brought me along, carried me around, and then this other guy sitting on his front row in his purple shirt, Pete, and I, all the way back through school. And then when we got out of school, Pete and I kind of started hanging together, piling around some and fishing. Well, he would let us tag along occasionally, and but he wouldn't tell us what he was doing. And you know, I say all that to bring it back to today. It hadn't been but just a couple of years that I wouldn't be telling you anything either. You know, that's just the way it was. But the Lord just kind of convicted me and told me, said, hey, look, a bunch of guys out there, and don't get me wrong, I'm not the best fisherman in the world. There's thousands of guys out there better than I am. But I don't think there's anybody out there loves it any more than I do. But being able to concentrate, being able to do what I do and do it the way that I do it, I hope today as we go through this, you'll get something out of it and be able to do something with it and use it. I'm married again, like I said, to that young lady in the back here, Frances. I got two boys here, my son Craig and my son Jason sitting in the back. Thanks for coming, guys. And real supportive, but hear about, I think it was Christmas, not this past Christmas a year ago. Jason lives in Baton Rouge area, and we were all sitting around the table, and I told him, I said, you know, I've been thinking about starting a little ministry, and I don't really know what I want to do and how I want to do it. So that really was all that was said. Well, about, oh, I don't know, 2 months later or something, about around February or whatever, I mentioned it to Pete and Charles, and both of those, I told them what I wanted to do, and they said, well, you know, hey, first thing out of Charles' mouth said, well, if the Lord wants you to do it, it will happen. And that kind of stuck with me, you know. I got to thinking, well, you know, is this what he wants me to do, or is it what I want to do? As you can tell, I'm not a speaker, so it wasn't what I wanted to do. But anything and anytime I can tell somebody about the Lord, I'll tell them. A lot of you guys I've met on the lake, and that's one of the first things that we, one of my favorite ways of doing it is after we, you know, if I'm catching fish and you come up to me and you ask me, say, hey, what are you using? How deep are you? What are you doing right now? And I'll tell them and all, we'll go through the whole scenario, and then when it's all over, I'll say, okay, I got a question for you now. And I ask them, do they know the Lord? It's funny, Mr. Dawkins sitting over here too, we were up there one day, and Charles and him and I were fishing over in the big lake. We were catching fish along the edge of that channel. And there was three guys come up from just out of nowhere, and they were drifting along there, and I was over there, and occasionally I'd pull one in the boat, pretty regular. They kind of eased over pretty close to me. They said, hey, man, we don't want to crowd you. We just want to know what you're using. So I got the chance and opportunity to talk to them from them. After it was all over, I said, okay, hey, look, guys, now I'd like to know a question from y'all. I said, do y'all know the Lord? Are you Christians? You know? One of them in the back of the boat just got he got to laughing. I said, uh-oh, I done messed up now. What do I say now? How do I do this? And the guy in the back of the boat said, well, wait. He said, hey, we're not laughing at you. I want you to meet our pastor. He's sitting in front of the boat. You know, so it was pretty cool. You know, and he's not the only one. There was a picture up here a while ago of people watching as it scanned through the videos. There was a couple holding a stringer of fish. That couple right there, that was the fish that I had caught that day. I had planned when I got back to the dock. I was loading my boat up, and I looked back, and this guy sitting over there just looking at me. And I turned my back, and I started getting my stuff more and more, you know. And I turned around, he's still looking at me. And I said, good evening. And he said, hey, how you doing? I said, y'all catching any? He said, no, we're not. I said, well, y'all like some fish? Yes, sir, we sure would. So anyway, I walked over there to him, and I said, well, what do you have to put them in? He said, well, you know, you got a bucket of ice chest? Ain't it? We got this stringer. I said, okay, come on. They'll come over, and I was going to get Mater 10. Well, when we walked up to the boat, he got to telling me, he said, man, I just retired. I said, you did? Well, good. I said, I'm retired too. He said, well, I just retired last week. Me and my wife both retired. We just turned 62. I said, well, good. He said, I draw $550 a month. He was just beaming about that. I said, how many of these fish you want? So I wound up giving him all of them. He strung them all up, and I took a picture of them. But, you know, I meet all kind of people at the boat dock, all kind of people all the time at the boat dock. And I think about a lot of times, Ted Smith sitting back there in the back. I don't know if y'all know Ted or not, but Ted was at the boat dock one day, and people didn't ask him. They just pulled a gun on him. You know, so today in this time, you've got to be careful with what you're doing. You've got to be careful in how you do things, how you approach people. But, you know, you kind of see, size them up and look at them and watch over them. I've, on my website, I don't know if you're all familiar with it or not, but it's seekersofmen.com. And if you hadn't visited and hadn't liked it, I'd appreciate you doing that, and kind of looking at it. There's cards back on the table back here if you like to pick a card up before you leave. And thought that was turned off. But anyway, there's all kind of people out there that you can run into in all kind of ways. I don't know how many of you guys in here know the Lord, but you know what? I hope all of you do, because, you know, just looking around in this room right here at this day and time, hey, the way things are, our presidential situation, our state situation, I'm not getting into politics, but just everything we know, you know if you like it or if you don't like it. But the only way it can change is through people that are Christians, that can discern what's going on, discern what the Lord has for our life, and you know, be able to get out and vote, be able to take care of the situation so we can stay and be able to enjoy what we do enjoy, and that's white perch fishing. Because, you know, if they, first thing they're going to do is they're going to try to take our guns away from us. If they take our guns away from us, then they're going to try to take our rod and reel, and that's going to be the draw straw right there. I don't know about y'all. If I have to use it for a switch, we're not going to let them do that. But anyway, hey, that's getting ready for the long haul. You know, as we go through life, we get ready for the long haul. And the long haul that I'm talking about is eternity. So if you're not ready for eternity, what are you doing with your life, and how are you getting ready for it? Are you getting ready to meet the Lord? Because, you know, this old, we got a little men's group that we've been meeting, and we had one of our sessions was on 1,000 years is like a day to the Lord, you know. I think about that now, 1,000 years in one day. You know, it's just that quick. The way I figured it, I'm about 2.5 days into my 1,000 years, you know, and that's real short. Because eternity, we can't fathom what eternity is. We can't fathom how long it is and how life is too short. Life is too short for us to play around with it. I myself played around with my life too many years. Been a Christian since I was early 18, 19 year old when I was baptized. And thanks to that lady back there is the reason I am. But you know, it's always somebody in your life that will touch your life and somebody in your life that'll lead you in the way that you need to go. So anyway, but anyway, Matthew, I got one scripture that I'd like to share with you, and then we'll get started into this other part of it. I know what you came today for, but because you came, I don't give refunds on your, so you have to listen to me. Okay, so anyway, but Matthew chapter 6, verse 20 tells us, don't store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust can destroy, and where thieves steal. But you know, that's just kind of paraphrased, but you know, we need to take that to heart. You know, no matter what we've got in this world, hey, when we leave here, we came here with nothing. Guess what we're going to leave with? Zero. I've been telling my two boys back there all the time, I'm trying to spend their inheritance. I worked hard all my life for it. Hey, it's about time for them to get out and work hard all their life for theirs. But you know, it is though, but I thank the Lord every day for my family, for the support that they give me. And I know you do too, and I know that your life is much better because of it. There's three guys that, one's a football player and two baseball players. I was partial to the baseball players because my two boys did play baseball. Both of them went to the professional ranks. They didn't make the big shows, but they did. And I never will forget my oldest one. He called me and he was coming home from the Canton Coyotes. I said, why are you coming home? He said, can't straighten my arm out. Bowed his elbow out. But you know, that happens. That happens in life. You have to take these things and go on with it. My youngest son, he played for the Tampa Bay Devil Rays. And you know, when he came home, it broke my heart. But you know what? It wasn't me playing ball, it was them. They had to make their life decisions. But I thank the Lord every day that they made those decisions and made the right decisions. And their decisions that they made was to love the Lord Jesus Christ with all their heart, all their soul, and all their mind. And you know, that means a lot. So, but the three guys that I'm talking about, one of them is Andrew Whitworth. A lot of you probably know Andrew. He's a fine Christian man. Big, probably couldn't walk through them doors if you don't know him. He's just that big. I think he's probably one of the number one tackles in professional football. But he loves the Lord and he professes it. He didn't just profess it in high school. He professed it in college. He professed it in the professional ranks. And you know, the other one is Albert Poole. If you know about him, he's a baseball player, one of the best baseball players of this day and time. But Albert, I was just happened to be going through the internet, just kind of scooping around, and there his name popped up. So I clicked on it, and it told his testimony of how when he was a child, when he came from Cuba, and how he come into the United States, and how he got to know and love the Lord, and how he met his wife, and it was really good. If you ever get a chance, you need to look his story up and look at him. And the other one is Clayton Kershaw. If you know him, he was the youngest pitcher. I think I'm going to say this right. If I'm not, Jason, tell me. But I think he was the youngest pitcher to ever win the Cy Young Award. And, you know, that's pretty impressive to be that young. I think he was 21, I think, when he won it. 20 or 21. That's pretty young. You know, you go all the way back if your boys or you played ball coming up, or if you were athletes and you know these kind of people, it's a stressful situation, especially trying to play that kind of sports and to keep the Lord first in your life. Same with today. Hey, every one of you in here are sportsmen. You may not think about it as being sportsmen, but you are. If you get out there and fish every day, hunt, whatever you do, it's all part of sports and all part of life. But anyway, hey, getting started today, we talk about the face of God a lot. You know, what does the face of God look like? Hey, turn, look around. You'll see what the face of God looks like. You know, it's us. You know, we're made in God's image. So, you know, every day, no matter if you're up on that lake, and I don't want to keep bringing Pete into this, but Pete and I have had this situation so many times. But you know, when you're out on the lake and you're catching white perch, especially if you fish Darbon Lake, and it's getting that way everywhere else too. But if you fish Darbon Lake and all of a sudden you look up and you catch a fish and you look up and there's a boat right beside you. Not way over there watching you, but right beside you, you know. And used to, I would tell them what I thought about it. But you know, I just kind of take a deep breath and turn around, turn my boat and head off somewhere else. But there's plenty of fish on Darbon to be found. You just got to find them, you know. But unless you're fishing with your buddy, he's in his boat, you know, it kind of deters you. But you know, the Lord may be testing you too. He tested me a lot of times. One of my favorite sayings, and I hope to the good Lord, I never said this to any of y'all, but that's I would say, hey, this Darbon Lake is a 15,000 acre lake. This is my little half acre. Go find yours, you know. But hey, sometimes it works, sometimes it didn't. But anyway, today, what y'all came for. Thanks for listening to me. But we're going to get started first on the short rig. I don't know if y'all use these very much or if you use them at all. I don't use these right here to cast with. We used to. We used to do it a lot. We used to throw them out, let them go down. Me and her dad sat at Darbon Lake one day and brought quite a few home. I won't say how many, but we brought quite a few home. And it was all, no, Pete, I don't want you to say either. But anyway, we sat at Darbon Lake and we caught quite a few fish, but we wasn't vertical jigging, we were casting. We would take and cast that out. Open your mouth, Pete. we would take and cast it out, let it go to the bottom, count it down to, if I was fishing 24 feet deep with that rig I've got on there right now, I'd go 1,001, 1,002, I'd go about that fast. And the time I got 24, it's about where it's at, I'd close that bell, I'd come in and pow, there we'd be. But now, I'm getting older, my wrists are not what they used to be, so now I just take and open that bell and just let her fall to the bottom and sit there and just wait on that thump. And that's what it's all about. So you may ask right here about this split shot. I don't know if all of you use it. Most of you probably do. But the split shot and this jig right here is vitally important when you fish deep water. And what I'm talking about deep water, when I call it deep water, I call it 15 feet or deeper. I got an opportunity here a couple weeks ago with Jeff Glover sitting over here, invited me to come down to Caney. I fished a lot of deep water. I fished Claiborne deep water. When you fish Claiborne, you fish deep water. When you fish Caney, you fish deep water. We were fishing out on humps that come up out of 35, 40 foot of water up into about 30 foot on top of them, 30 to 32 feet, and I was fishing 31 foot deep, catching fish. That's why you want to have this right here on there, and plus I use a 16th ounce head 90% of the time. It's a 16th ounce head. I do get a lighter head occasionally, and I do get a heavier occasionally. But that's all in your preference and all in what you want to do and how you want to do it. But main thing is when you're out there with this rig right here, is knowing how deep you are. And this right here I know is a 7 foot rod. Right here I'll bring that bait to the bottom of that rod. And most of you may know this, you may not. If you ever hear that or read one of my posts where I'm fishing 20 foot deep, I'm fishing 20 foot deep. Okay, so it's 7 foot here. If you see these yellow marks, that's a 1 foot mark and that's a 2 foot mark. So that's 7 feet. That's 9 feet. 11 feet. And so forth right on down the line till I get to where I want to be. And then when I get there, I should have 11 feet of line out. So when I get right there, seven, I've got a tape measure up here. That should be 4 feet. And it's pretty much right on the money. Especially if you know, one thing you gotta do, you gotta get your tape measure, know your rod, know how long your rods are. this point right here on my reel is my measuring point. From here to here is 2 feet. If I want to fish 15 feet, if I need 1 foot, then I'll go to here, close my bail. Now on this type of reel, this type of rod and reel, you got another advantage that you don't have on a spool reel or a bait casting reel or a push button reel. The advantage you have on this that you don't have on those is this little keeper right here on the side. I don't know if y'all can see that or not, but when you get to where you want, the depth you want, the depth of your water that you want, you take and get your line, flop it under that right there. You reel your bait back up after you catch your fish, bring them in the boat, get them off, and then you just whip your bait back out there and look at there. I'm right back to that same spot where I caught fish. I don't have to guess. I don't have to know. I already know where I'm fishing. I know how deep I'm fishing and the depths. That's all. And I use these 7 foot rods. I've got a 7, a couple of 8s that I use this time of year on, because when you're fishing deep water, you don't have to be able to reach out there and poke old scooter with it. You know, you just need to, you can back up here, you can, anywhere you want to, and you hold that thing as comfortable. I'm getting old, I kind of cheat. I got a couple of armrests on my, I just set my arm there and then here I go. I'm eased down through there. And while we're on that subject, if I'm fishing 20 foot deep, well, let's back all the way up. Earlier in the year, we started out anywhere from 12 to 16 feet is what we started out catching back in the fall. Fall fish, and this is a winter time situation, they were 16. As the water column starts getting cooler, they start going down. I followed them all the way from 12 foot down. I'm about 20 feet now. I do fish 22 and 24 feet occasionally. Most of the time, I hang in. Gene and I went up there last week, a week or so ago, and we were fishing 20 feet all day long. We never changed. And what I do when I say I'm fishing along the, Craig, have you got that map of the lake? When I'm fishing along the channel edges, and I say I'm fishing 20 feet deep with this rig right here, and this line right in here, that's the channel. And pretty much you can see some of my, of course, the 33 bridge there, you know about it. 33 bridge, you know, all my years of fishing, I have never passed up a bridge, never. I don't care if it's 6 foot deep or 40 foot deep, I don't pass a bridge up. I love bridge fishing, always have. I started bridge fishing, let me back up one more time, give you a little story. Back in the 65, 66, when Jake's had a boat dock. You know, they call that Jake's Landing now. But that landing they call Jake's is actually, that was a public landing at that time. Jake's was actually over where that marina, not marina, but the cafe's at. That was Jake's boat dock, had a floating dock out there. Her dad had a boat and a motor. Guess what? I didn't. So I rented a boat. We put everything in, get going. I said, well, where are we going? He said, I don't know where I'm going. I'm going over here. I don't know where you're going. So he said, paddle out there to that bridge. Hey, there's some fish out there. He'd take off. He may go down to Terrell Island. He may go up to the forks or whatever fish. Me, I'd paddle out there to that bridge. Tie up to that bridge. I had a rod just about this long. Had a Mitchell 300 on it. It didn't at the time, but I had it on there. And I would catch white perch out there just by doing that. A few years later, what really got us started into this was Pete and I was in a bass tournament up there. I don't know if y'all remember the Washtenaw Bass Club or not. We were fishing that tournament one day. So we come along right about there, we go under that bridge, and I had a flasher. Well, I was uptown by then. I had me a fiberglass boat with a flasher on it. And that thing just lit up. And I said, boy, look at that, Pete. He said, what's that? I said, I know what that is. I reached and I had a rig in my boat. I don't think Pete had one. He used a 5,000 that day, didn't he? Rigged up a jig on it. And we quit bass fishing in that tournament and started catching white perch. You know, hey, we were out there to catch fish. But anyway, I bring that up to say that bridge has been there and it's been that away for umpteen number of years. So if you're ever fishing on Darbone, you might wanna try that one spot right there. Of course, you're gonna have to get in line more than likely. 90% of the time, you've got to get in line to try it. But anytime you're fishing along, all the way from right in through here, all the way up through the channels, when I tell you I'm posting and I'm fishing on the edge of channels, that's what I'm doing. I've tried this scenario from right there at that dam to up here, Boatwright Creek. I haven't been above Boatwright Creek, but most of you know where Boatwright Creek's at. I've fished the Boatwright Creek. Got some friends fish all the way up to the Hog Pen. They like it up there. Then come back and all the way up into Rattlesnake Bend up in here, right out from the state park, that Rattlesnake Bend, all the way up to what you call the mixing hole. I have fished all of that through there for years back. I done most of that up in there back in the 90s, and then I had to work for a living. And when you got to work for a living, you only got one day a week off to fish. My prime number one place to go was Darbone Highway 33 Bridge or Highway 2 Bridge, just depending on the wind and where it was at. So I could go out there and fish any of those spots without a depth finder right now. I still use my depth finder, but I could do it without it. But I'm not bragging about that. It's just how much I've fished. I could go down here around one of the channel turns and head back toward Bear Creek, what they call Bear Creek Run. That's the channel turn. Going to come in by Pine Island over there. I say that to always check your creeks out. Your creeks are critical in a situation like this. This is a single jig rig that you can take, and I hope I don't catch fish. But anyway, if you drop that jig, and if I can get him in there, if you drop that jig in that water and you try to hold him still, hey, if you'll notice, I can't hold him still. Anybody thinks they can hold that jig still, I'd like to see them come up here and try, because, and I'm not being ugly about that, I would, I'd like to see it. But a jig, as it's moved around in that water right there, hey, a lot of times you don't have to do this heavy popping on a jig. Sometimes you do, but what triggers a white perch a lot of times, I think, is when that jig is in that water and they fall. Whenever that jig falls or rises, that's when you get they're just like bass. You know, a lot of us growing up bass fishing and white perch are almost like bass. They hang the structure, they hit jigs, they hit rigs like this. But that jig, when it's sitting in that water, you try to hold it real still, and you try to, and I ain't having no look at it. But anyway, that's what aggravates that jig. It aggravates that white perch, is that jig sitting in that water. And then Friday, I carried my youngest son fishing with me. And you know, we're easing along there, and he's ripping my head. I don't like it, but it happened. You know, here I am in the front of the boat. He's using my rod and my reel and my baits, and he's catching my fish. But we're going along there, and we're just talking, and we're talking about it. We're going along there, and all of a sudden I said, "Can you see the end of my pole? Did it do that?" I said, "Craig, you just got a hit." He said, "No, I didn't." I said, "I saw your pole." He said, "Hey, see my finger right here? Watch my finger. Watch that pole." Okay? I got bit with my own little trick. Okay? He had been doing that all morning. I hadn't. I had been holding mine still. He had been giving it that little pop. I'm going to tell you, you don't think it'll make a difference, but it will. Just little subtle things like that. We pulled up to a tree, sat there and sat there and sat there. And now all of a sudden I said, you know, pow! There he popped it. You can do that. A lot of times in the spring, we'll get one little shot in the spring, we're not going to go and stay there. One little, when you run that thing in there in a tree, and you got that thing sitting in there and you're holding it, and they're not hitting it, they're not biting on it that day, you take and roll that line. Roll that line in your fingers. What it'll do is it'll turn that jig round and round. If you like, get you a fish bowl and get home. That's what I love to do this. Frances gets mad at me sometimes. I'll bring it in the living room in there, and she'll be in there watching one of her soap operas, and I'll have that bowl, and I'll be sitting in my chair just popping it in there and doing different things with it just to see what happens and what kind of action the baits have. And that's one thing that you can do. It's just little subtle things, but one thing that you can do, the main thing is whenever you talk to somebody, if they give you an honest answer about how they're catching them, where they're catching them, and the depth they're catching them, listen to them. Another thing you got to do too when you're fishing that, and we're gonna call this line right here 18 feet, and we're gonna call this line right here 22 feet. I've got my jig, and I'm fishing 20 foot deep, but I'm trying to stay in that zone, in that 18 to 22 feet. If you're in the front of the boat, you can truly front end somebody this way, okay? Because that guy in the back of the boat, hey, if you're fishing this, okay, Pete. Pete knows. But if you're fishing this kind of rig, and you're fishing that away, then you know that you're gonna keep that bait right in there. I hope everybody can see that. But anyway, if you're fishing in there, and you're in 18, 22, okay, here I am fishing 20 feet deep. I'm trying to make this straight line down through here in 20 foot of water. I'm holding that thing. Okay, as I turn my boat, which I do it on purpose, turn my boat and head into that 18 foot of water, that jig is still back there in 22, okay? Okay, as it comes around and it gets over here, now that jig's in, we'll call that 20 foot of water, okay? It still hadn't made this 18 foot yet. So it's kind of pendling down. So think about that when you're fishing too. It's still pendling down. So when I say we're catching them at 20 feet deep, I may go into that 18 foot of water, okay? But after I do that and it comes back and it's pendling around, I see that jig kind of coming on in there pretty close to 18, I'll turn my boat back. Guess what? Now we've come up maybe to 19 feet with that jig, maybe. Okay, and then we're gonna turn around, we're gonna head back the other way. When it gets right there, then I'm maintaining that zone right in this square right here, pretty much in that 20 foot of water where I want to be. But you've got to do that real slow and real subtle. You can't put your trolling motor on high, even in high wind, you can't put it on high. You've got to regulate your trolling motor out to where you're not doing any of this jerky, herky motions. You don't want that, because when you get here, I'm in 18 foot of water, I'm gonna go back out to 22. That's exactly what happens to that jig right there. Same thing. When you go back the other way, that's exactly what happens to it right there. And as you take off forward, you're right here, hey, that thing's still back here, and you're taking off up here. You're bringing that jig up out of the zone, out of the water. So that's just one little thing. That's just on this one right here. But I love these kind of rods like this. It's just my preference because of the facts that I just told you about. So the little clip on the side.
What's your action on that rod there, Sam? Is that just
a medium action. I've got it's not a heavy, it's kind of a medium action. Right. But I do have some light action. The one Craig was using Friday was real light. I mean, when you've got you could get a 10 or 11 incher on there, it looked like you had a pound and a half fish on it. Get a pound and a half on it, looked like you got a whale on it. And it's just all in action, but it just depends on what you want and how you want to use it. I like this type of rod like this when I'm fishing treetops. Entirely different story, entirely different game. But when I'm fishing treetops, I don't care if I'm fishing shallow or I'm fishing deep. I'll probably say 65% of the time I'll use this rod or this action rod because I rig my jigs like I showed Jay back there a while ago and I've got it on my site too about how I rig a Bobby Garland jig weedless. And when I use that weedless rig, that's the way I use it. I've gotten Charles has started using that pretty regular. What kind of rod do you use? You know, is that a heavy or medium or?
About a medium.
So anything will work, but what you've got to really remember on that is you got to be able to bury that hook. You got to be able to set it to them. You got to be able to sock it to them, in other words, on that. But those jigs like that, anyway, on this rod right here, this is my favorite all time. And then if on occasion, and I do, I can't sit here and say I don't, but on occasion if I do, still got that Cheney Lake jig on there, Ted. But anyway, if I do use this rod right here on spider rigging, which I do spider rig, can't say I don't like it. I do it occasionally, and I'll do it more on post spawn than I do in the wintertime. But on this rig right here, the same thing, and I don't think I got enough room to do this. We're gonna try it. I don't know.
How long is your rod?
That's what I'm just fixing to show you and tell you. This one right here is 11 foot. There I go again. I got the 11 foot of line out. Grab that piece. Sit out. Okay. I got the 11 foot of line out. There I go. I got the 1 foot and 2 foot. On all my rods, I've got them marked. Same thing. Now I've got 11, and I can go right here. It's 13 feet. There again, I got the little clips on the side of my reel that I can clip them in. Then when I get ready to go back, if you use a long rod like this, you can go back to the 13 feet. Bam. You back, you don't have to worry about where you're at. You don't have to worry about recounting. Just little things like that that makes life a whole lot easier on a fisherman.
Sam, I noticed you don't have a weight on that one, but you had a weight on the other one. When do you change sizes of your weight depending on the wind?
I do. Yeah, that's a good question, Mike. I do, really. This past week has been with really high winds on Darbone. A lot of times I went to a two weight. But most of the time I try to stay out of that high wind. I've got one rig that's just like this over here that's got the weight on the bottom. It's a 1/2 ounce weight, and I've got two jigs tied to it that I will use, that I did use some this week. And you can also probe the bottom with it a whole lot easier. I know Jeff uses that down at Caney a lot. We won't say what he puts on there. It's not jigs, it's that other thing. And anybody got any idea? No, I'm just kidding. I'm not knocking shiners. Shiners, they got their purpose. $16 a pound, I think they are now, aren't they? Not about what they cost. Whew, that's a lot of money. Buy lots of jigs for that. But anyway, this right here, and another thing you want to remember too, okay, if I'm fishing, I'm just going to call that 8 foot, whatever. If I'm fishing 8 foot, all of a sudden I want to come up to 6 foot. Mm-hmm. I just took 2 foot of that line up. Now, how do I know that?
Yeah.
Huh? Okay. Come up right here. I'm right at the end of it. Open that thing up. Remember I told you, you got a 2 foot mark here. Pull your 2 foot of line out. Close that thing up. Watch. One. And all 3/4. And it's up to, you done took 2 foot of line up. So if you want to know if you're fishing 20 foot and you just want to change to 18 just to see, maybe you saw something on your depth finder you liked or whatever, hey, flop her on up there. You can change it to that 2 foot without an issue and without a problem. Okay? This rig right here, one thing I wanted to show y'all too, I'm gonna try this again. Man, there won't be no fish in there. But anyway, here we go. All right, now, notice how much that jig jumping around, notice how much I'm moving that rod. Hey, that's a good bit. I don't know, can all y'all see that? Okay. It doesn't take much. It doesn't take a lot. Now watch the line in my hand. See, that's more subtle. That would be a little more agitation, I guess. Be a word for it that you could agitate the fish with. You can agitate them just a little bit better by easing in there to that old cypress tree and just kind of give it a flop or two like that. Hey, and they'll... Man, I'm telling you, sometimes that got about that much line out, and we're getting back in the spring again. It's getting out of where, but anyway, he just knocks the fire from it. And if you have never felt that, if you don't know what I'm talking about, hey, spring's coming on. Find you some shallow water, find you some spring spawning fish, and get your old heart agitated. If you got a bad heart, you may not want to do it. But there are several things. Now, another thing I want to show you too. You're getting pretty close on.
What size line do you use most time?
Okay, I use 6 and 8. I use 6 pound, and I use this line right here is coated. My glasses on, it's clear. It's fluorocarbon coated line. If you know about fluorocarbon line, you know what fluorocarbon line does. Fluorocarbon line sinks better, holds down better. That's why I have gone to 8 pound. I used to use nothing but 4 and 6. Well, you lose a lot of fish on 4, break off. So getting older and retired, I can't afford to lose all them jigs, so I went up to 6 and 8. But if you're still working, 4 works real good. But hey, this little hair jig right here, I don't know if any of you recognize that little jig, but if y'all can't see from back there, you need to, don't hurt, come up here and stand by the table a minute, whatever you want to do. Come up here and look at it. I can find that line. That's the bad thing about clear line. A lot of people use green, yellow, red. I don't really think it matters. The only place that matters is right here, I think. Maybe wrong. It's up here with me. I don't use that kind of line. I use clear line exclusively. So you can just about bet that you can't see it. But anyway, you drop that old hair jig in there, we got an entirely different scenario. Look at that. Even I can hold it still. Huh? Of course, I don't have it stuck out on no 10-foot pole either, or a 5 or 6 foot pole. But look at that hair. You can't see it. Look at that hair and that movement that jig's got. That in the springtime to me is what drives a white perch crazy. Now, a lot of people hair jigs exclusively, which that's great. I started out back when I was telling y'all back there earlier, back out on that bridge out there, all I could get was hair jigs. You remember old marabou? Yeah. Marabou jigs? That's about all we had. We had marabou jigs. Then Miles, a company called Miles out of Winsboro, and then Slater still makes jigs, made hair jigs. And my favorite colors were white with a red head. White with a chartreuse head, and that's primarily the only two jigs I ever used. Francis and I were over at Gashaway one year. We was using that other word, that shiner. No. Anyway, we were using shiners, and I hate to say that, but we were. We were using shiners, and this guy was coming along. He was in a We were in a little small aluminum boat, and I was paddling too. And here comes this guy paddling, had a cane pole and line about that long, sticking it up in them, if you ever been to Gashaway, sticking it up in them buttonwillers on the far side over there. You know, thanks to our state, we can't go in there anymore, but that's another story. And he was catching them things, and Francis and I were just ooh and on. You know, my old mouth was drooling. I didn't have any jigs with me. He'd come up there and he said, "Y'all catching it?" I said, "Yeah, you hitting these shiners every now and then." Well, he gave us 4 jigs right off his head. They hitting these right here. That was what put me on Miles jigs at that time. That was in what, 70, 71, somewhere in that neighborhood. We were pretty young. But anyway, so I rigged our poles up, boy, and I get in there and I stick that thing in there, and she sticks hers in there, and I'm hung. I said, "Do what?" "I'm hung." Well, it's too late, you know, you can't just turn them boats around, breaks off. Well, now we're down to 3 jigs. Still ain't caught a white perch, okay? So I tie her the other jig on there, and we go up there, and And boy, I mean, I propped that thing in there, and that rascal, like, took it, rod, pole, and everything out of my hand. I got him in a boat, big old white perch over there. Got him in there, and finally I used her around there, and I'm hung. So she loses that jig. So now we're down to two jigs. Now, I ain't lost one of mine yet. But, hey, being the loving husband that I am, I tied another jig on her pole. I get in there, and I think, if I remember correctly, I caught another one right off. I'm hung.
Oh, no.
I said, well, just hold on a minute. So I made her stay in that bush hung up, and I think I managed to catch about two more before I got mine hung. Well, now we're down to one jig. And just to make her feel better, I put it on her pole. She never did catch fish on that jig, I don't think. But we did from that point on, start on. But hair jigs have always been a super bait on white perch anywhere. I don't care what depth you are. I just don't use them a lot of times in deep water. But that don't mean that they won't catch fish. They will catch fish.
Sam, who makes your favorite hair jig?
Sir?
Who makes?
Oh, this right here, this jig is a Black Lake jig.
It's
a Black Lake 120 with R. It's called Black Lake 120. Well, it doesn't have the R in it anymore. If it's 120R, it'll have one red stripe on it. Piece of
thread.
And I believe it does have it. Yeah, there it is right there. It's in there, I just can't see it. But it's in there. But I like the Black Lake jigs. I like the plain without 120. But both of them are good jigs. Can all of you can... Why don't you turn those lights on in the back there just a second? Huh? Yeah. That's the 120. I don't know if y'all can see that loop knot right here that I've got tied. Okay, on there. Charles grinning at me because years ago he started tying loop knots, but he ties his different than I do. And he come over and show me all about his loop knot, and I got aggravated. I don't use that thing. I wouldn't use that loop knot to you. But anyway, this is the knot that I've used. And of course, that was back before I got, revived or whatever, and started telling him, okay, I will tell you the whole truth. Used to, I'd stretch it a little bit. I'm a fisherman too, all right? Hey, all fishermen can stretch it anywhere they want to. But anyway, that loop knot right there, used to, years ago, we started out tying and pulling down to your jig on a hard knot all the way down, no loop in it at all. And if you remember, every time you'd go and throw it out there and get a hitch, you'd have to come in, grab it and pull it back, make sure your jig was hanging straight and all that kind of stuff. Well, this right here takes all that out of it. It don't matter what you're doing. You can jerk him out of there. When you get ready to flip it back in there, it's going to come back in. And you can see it's going to hold straight. It's level. That's one pretty critical instance that you need. You always want your jig parallel. I'm not saying that a fish won't hit a dying bait, because they will, but a bait that's just sitting there like this, I don't think there's any action in that bait. They may hit it. I'm not saying they hadn't caught fish on them like that, but you want that up there in the way of a shad or a shiner or whatever they're supposed to be, whatever kind of action's supposed to be in there. You want it to do this way, not like this. So you always want your jigs to hang straight. Now are y'all interested in that knot? Anybody?
Yes, I am. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, it's not that difficult, I don't think. I hope not. Move in right here. Hope y'all see me from right here. We're going to start all over.
While he's he's doing that, does anyone want a bottle of water?
Hey, anybody? Anybody want any fish? Anybody want to catch any fish? Well, I tell you what, catching them fish, I'm ready. Anyway, it's pretty easy to tie. You just take and put it through your eye if I can. Like I said, I'm so nervous nowadays. Always have been, but seems like it's getting worse. Okay, you come up, you got two lines right here. After you bring it through, okay? Just take and grab it like this. These two fingers, just take and wrap that line around those two fingers and leave a gap right here. Okay, see that? Take that jig and drop it in there one, two, three times. Take your finger and put in that right there and just kind of pull on that a little bit. You can make this as narrow down as you want. And you can take this something like this and stick it in there. Pull it all the way down to your bait if you want it that close. I don't ever try that. I don't worry about that. It's not that critical that I get it down there to where it's a reel. That's probably got a 1-inch gap in that.
You ever check it to see how much it lessens about the strength of the line?
Do I ever see what now? How much it's stretching the line?
How much it lessens the strength of the line. Does it then become maybe 5 or 6, or, you know?
It probably does.
It
probably,
how hard does it break?
It's kind of like using a pulley or something, you know, where you've got a double. Is that what you're talking about? Stretching?
Strength.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about, the strength of it. It's, I tell you what, I can't break it. But I tell you, when you get hung up, a lot of times, what's happened, a lot of times, one thing that you want to do is, if you're fishing treetops, or if you're fishing real brushy areas, I do try to get that loop down closer. So that loop will get on the limb. Okay, when you're fishing the weedless rig, not this right here, when I'm fishing my weedless rig, I do try to get that loop down, because that, I don't know, I guess it's just like kind of jump out of an airplane with a fish tape like we used to talk about in the old electrical world. That thing's going to hang on everything in the world before it gets to the bottom. Okay? But that's what that will do too. But that right there is the knot that I use primarily most of the time on any of my jigs.
What you got against the little quick clip?
Pardon?
The little quick clip.
The little quick clip, yeah, I've used those before. It works the same way. I'm not saying it's...
Yeah, I like it because I can change color stuff.
Yeah, sure. And it does. It makes it easier to change. I've tried those before. There again, I think more than anything, it's mental. Mm-hmm. You know, I've got a mental block to it because of the metal clip right there. But if you think about it, you got a metal clip right here where you're clipping into. So it probably is. That's why I'm saying it's probably a good idea. It works the same way.
You got a good idea of what you're going to fish with, what color and stuff like that. Or I give it a change a lot.
Sure. Well, I do too, but hey, with that little deal right there, I'd sit there while I'm watching other poles and run that thing around there. Once you get used to it, drop it in there 3 times, pull it on there without ever even looking at it. But, you know, that's up to the individual how you'd like to try to do it.
Hey Sam, when you run it through your eye, are you doubling it or just single?
No, it's just single run through.
Okay.
Now there's other ways to tie that loop knot, and that's where you turn a tie half. Don't you do yours that way, Charles? Tie.
I think I'd run around my fingers a couple times.
Okay, and then back through it. Yeah. But
I think I like your way better.
Well, I'm not saying my way's better. I'm not saying it's really whatever a fisherman likes, whatever a fisherman wants. And that's, I'm gonna tell you, I found out over the years that 90% of this catching fish is believing in yourself and patience. You can go out there and, I've been out there many a time, and my little wife back there, she's my biggest supporter. She calls me about 8:30, 9 o'clock, said, well, what are you doing? I said, I've got one fish in the boat. Well, you need to go down to such and such. And I'll tell her, I'll say, well, you know, you might ask. I mean, you know what? I don't I go down there, and you know what? Most of the, 90% of the time, I go down there, I'm going to catch them. Now, I don't know if it's because she's psychic about it or because she gave me the confidence to go down there and fish a little harder for it.
$10 for my number.
But she does give out information on that, too. So, but anyway, that's, and I've been up there many a time fishing, and I know one other guy in here fishes kind of about like I'd walk up with you. But I do know Ted, when he goes fishing, he goes fishing. And when he says he goes fishing, it's daylight. And it's, now usually when I see his truck pulling back in, he's my next door neighbor. Usually when I see his truck pulling back in, it's dark. You know, or it's getting dark. It's right there at it. And he can probably verify this too. I know Pete and Charles can, because I fished with these guys so much. Okay, the reason I keep using their names so much. But, you know, when you go out there and fish till dinner, and I've been out there many a time, I have, at dinner, didn't have a fish. When I come home, have 35 or 40, you know, or 10 or 12, whatever the mode or whatever happens. I say this a lot, there are a couple of ladies in here, I'm sorry, fish are like perch are like women. You think you got them figured out? Forget it, man.
Amen.
But you know what, we say that jokingly, you know, but hey, we love them to death, we can't do without them. Okay, so, but that's one of my little jokes that I use around, most of the time around guys. I usually don't try to say it when my wife's around or anybody else. But she's heard me say it before, and I say it jokingly, but white perch are a funny, I tell you what, they're just a hard fish to pattern a lot of times, sometimes. But if you ever get on that pattern, if you ever get you a pattern started, hey, you can nail their heads, you know. What about some more questions? Anybody else got any other questions there on the deep water fishing?
Do you ever paint your jig heads?
I do. Now, on Darbon Lake and Darbon Bay, I fish Darbon Lake, Darbon Bay, and the river mainly. On the Darbon Bay and the river and Darbon Lake, to me, it's a lead head or a pink head. I do like a pink head, but far as varying off of that, and I can be persuaded to use colored heads. If somebody starts ripping them pretty much, it's kind of like niblets. I don't use niblets. I don't condemn niblets, and I don't say nothing about it. But, you know, it's there again, I think it's a mindset, you know. But I've been out there, I don't know if y'all know Kenny Haddock's or not. Kenny Haddock's called me a while back and wanted to fish, and so we went fishing, and Kenny used his niblets. Well, I was catching fish, he wasn't. But he all of a sudden caught a fish. He said, "Hey, you want one of these niblets?" I said, "No." Well, before just a short time, he caught another one. Boy, I did. "Sure you don't want some of these niblets?" I said, "No, I don't want the niblets." But I said, "I tell you what, you catch another fish, you won't get back in that hole. I'll make sure you stay out there in that deep water." But you know, if you're in control of the boat, you can control the situation. So, but no, I say that jokingly, because a lot of my friends use niblets, and it's just all in what you want to use and what your preference is to it. It's a good question, though.
I don't ever fish a jig head unless it's got an eye on it. Some people will not fish a jig head with an eye. What do you think?
Well, there again, like I told you, see that lead head?
Yeah.
This jig, right here, by the way, I won't give any information on where I get this jig head, but I'll tell you what, they sure are fine jig heads. But that's a 16th ounce sickle hook jig that a real good friend of mine makes and lets me have some occasionally. And he don't let me have some occasionally, he keeps me supplied with them. But anyway, that lead head right there, if I do paint them, I'll powder coat them. And this guy right here is the powder coater. He's the one that did really get me started on powder coat. I used to take my wife's pink fingernail polish when she wasn't looking, paint me some up pink and do that. But Randy got me on powder coat, and now when I make powder coat jigs, I'll take these same sickle hook 16th ounce and put that powder coat on them, change them to pink, and use those. Because Darmon Lake, I don't know what it is about Darmon Lake. Darmon Lake loves a pink head sometime, not all the time. Prime example was Friday when Craig and I was up there. He was using this jig right here, this glitter critter. I was using everything in my arsenal, was not catching any fish. But I think back on it, I don't know if it may have been that finger twitch he was doing that I forgot about, you know, trying. But I'm telling you, that's they wouldn't touch a pink head jig for me up there. Yes, sir.
Does that jig head have a collar on it?
No, it's just
a, it doesn't have a collar, you know.
Mm. No, it's just a plain jig head with a barb.
Yeah. Oh yeah, that's what I call a collar.
Oh, is it? Okay. It does. Now that barb that's on this jig, even in deep water fishing, in certain situations in deep water fishing, that this right here, when you take it off, I'll take my tweezers or clippers right here and clip that barb off. Clip it off, make it smooth. In other words, it'll be a smooth shank on it. I'll take then where you run your hook in and come out the top, I'll take and run my hook in the and come out the bottom. Let me put my glasses on. Have that thing in my hand here in a minute. I'll take and run it out the bottom like that. Okay? Everybody see that? And then just take and run it up in there. Right, I've got that barb now cut off. Before I do anything else, before I run it up on that, I'll take and rotate it. Okay, see, now I'm rotated up like this. Then I take and push that jig on up on there. You don't need that barb anymore. That barb is not necessary to hold the jig, because what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take that jig and I'm going to put it right in, right above that back. Just barely. I'm going to bring it up through it, and then I'm going to bring it back down to where that point's not in there. Now, you can see. See, that jig is oh, well, let me get in on there, button. I got it. Watch the eyeballs.
He has a nervous twitch.
I got more than that. It's getting worse. She says that's why I catch so many fish. Well, get up on there. Without that barb, it'll slide on there better. But anyway, that's not a real good push on there because the jig's already tore a little bit. But it makes it weedless. That's what I was telling y'all. That's what I was telling y'all about fishing in treetops. The way it comes in there and it's weedless. Bobby Garland, I tell you what, Slabinator's starting to come out with a good jig too. A little tougher body. I'm gonna have to try it a little more than I've got some. I'm gonna have to try it a little more. They are a little cheaper. The Slabinator jigs are, and they're tougher. Where this jig right here, tears is real soft. No, I think he's out of Missouri, I think. Slabinator? Maybe I'm wrong. No, I don't know. Pardon? Yeah, and that makes it weedless. Works too, don't it, y'all?
Sam, I got a question.
Yes, sir.
When you're fishing with two jigs, how do you tie off your top?
Okay, good question. Same way, I take this, get rid of that.
Yeah.
good to have a pair of pliers.
Do you have to wet it before you tie your knot?
Say it again?
On your fluorocarbon line, do you have to wet it before you really cinch it tight, or do you?
Yeah, it's a good idea to do it. It's a good idea to do it on anything. On monofilament or fluorocarbon, either one, keeps it from getting that stretch marks in it. Is that what you're talking about?
Well, I've heard it burns your line.
Yeah, it does. I'll tell you what, this light's not too good for me. Anyway, talking about two jigs, if I want to put three jigs, just depend on how much line I want to run through here, but two jigs, I'll run it through about that far, pull it down, tie this top one on there, tie it on there naturally, and then drop it through one, two, three times. There again, this part right here, to me, is not that critical. On that high jig, you got this right here, it's better anyway. Stand by. Hold that for just a second. All right, then I'll take that bottom one, and if I want it about a foot apart, it's just like you tie the old style. Before we use these loop knots, done the other way around. I don't know, Jack, when you use those clips, do you use a double rig? And you use clips on the double rig?
Line through it.
Do you?
And tie a couple of regular knots and it.
Yeah. Anyway, you take the same thing. If you want about a foot in there, fine. There you are. I'm gonna show you something else in just a second. Reason I'm doing it this way. Three times. Pull that rascal down there. Ow. Good and tight. Okay, you got a double rig jig. A double jig rig, whatever you want to call it.
You still put your sinker on there? You only use it?
Yes, sir. That's what I was just fixing to show you. Now, you can do this one of two ways. You can put your jig, your sinker up here, above it, or you can put it below it. When I put it below it, I try to use this is a pretty good size sinker, but I try to use just a little bit bigger one. I've got a half ounce on the one that, like I've got rigged up here. But one good thing about these slip sinkers, when you use a slip sinker like this, and you've got it on the bottom, of course I'd have more than that down there. I'd have at least a foot to 18 inches below this jig right here. I'd let that thing all the way to the bottom. Excuse me. Then you can feel that bottom right here. Look where them jigs are. You got one a foot off the bottom. You got one 2 foot off the bottom. If for some reason that weight gets hung up, you don't lose your two jigs. You just pull that old slip. It'll just slip right on out. So you don't put any knots or anything on this part right here. Okay. That way, if it gets hung up, bam, it comes off, zip, right on up you come. Is that your question? Sure. Is that answering? Robert, is that?
Oh, yeah, that's a knot.
Okay. Yeah, that's the way I do it. And that's the way it hangs, too. Tell you what, you can even tell when it's in the, I ain't got a jig on it, but it'll still give the same effect. Like, get in there. Get in there. All right, anyway, that jig right there on the top, even with that loop, see, it's staying away from that line. So it's hanging in there real good. Same way. Any other questions?
What are your top three colors?
That's this time of the year, that glitter critter I had on there. The penny back.
What was that one? Penny?
penny back. These are all Bobby Garland colors now. But the Glitter Critter, the penny back, sweet tea with lemon, the bluegrass, you can just go on and on, but that's...
Monkey milk,
thank you. Yeah.
Crystal.
What else, Pete? Crystal, yeah. Crystal's a new color they've come out with. It's pretty much like a double silver rainbow, with the exception of the glitter under the belly's not there. It's on, it's, here, this right here is a crystal. See, it's got the silver plates, and you look on the belly, it's white. The belly's white. Crystal, white. Called crystal. That's the, what bag did I get that out of? Yeah, whatever. Anyway, any other questions? I'll tell you what, I wanted to get in some other stuff too. This library closes at 5. We still got time for some more questions if y'all got some.
You ever fish a tube jig, but tube jig? You fish a tube jig?
I do. My favorite, that one I had on that other one, still on that one over there, I think, was that black and chartreuse. Out of my black and chartreuse tube jigs, my favorite black and chartreuse tube jig comes from Bass Pro Shop. It's their brand, black and chartreuse. If you ever get them and get one of them and compare it to another black and chartreuse, you'll see it's a little different color. Oh, but there again, black and chartreuse. Oh, I love the black and chartreuse. I love the, I don't know, the crickets, the pink ones. Oh, pink card me, didn't it, Ted? But the pink ones and all that. You know, the guy went fishing with Pete and I here a few years ago, and he started catching me. He said, oh, man, all they want is a little bit of pink. You know, and that's true. That day they wanted a little pink. There again, back you think you got them white perch figured out, they're going to change your mind. You may go up there today, just like the other day, I went up there and ripped their heads on the glitter, not glitter critter, but the crystal, the penny back, and the sweet tea. Went up there with Craig and I Friday, went up there, nothing but glitter critter. They wouldn't touch mother jig, maybe just me. But I'm telling you, they wouldn't do it. And I've seen that before. Used to, I wouldn't fish nothing but a black and chartreuse. That's about all I had in my boat was black and chartreuse jigs. About it. You remember that, don't you, Randy? But that was black and chartreuse. But any other questions? Anything?
When you started out, you looking for fish, if you had been in a few days, and you use your electronics, or you just...
I do. There's Craig, I don't know if you can go to that picture of that ball of shad. Oh, yes, sir. I love that. I love to watch for fish. I keep bringing this up from Friday with Craig, but we was up there Friday and we was eating along. Craig was yah, yah, yah. I said, hey, be quiet a minute. He said, what? I said, right here. I said, we fishing, get a bite right here. You know what I mean? I saw the fish on the bottom. Sure enough, as soon as they pendled them in, pow, there they were. You know, so yes, you can.
You saw the fish or you saw the shad?
I saw the fish. This ball of shad right here, I don't know if you can see this, the way it's grown up right here, big old ball of shad. Now these are fish. What kind of fish? I don't know if they're bass, white perch, what they are, but hey, they're following that ball of shad. They fixing to scatter them here in just a minute. But yeah, I look for that too. We fished there again Friday. Well, I had a ball of shad working on off a couple of trees right on the edge of that channel. I saw them. They'd swing out in the channel, they'd come back. They'd swing out in the channel, they'd come back. Because as they started moving across my graft, I started moving my boat, trying to stay with them. I'm not that good. I can't stay with them. But I did know which way they were heading. I didn't know where they were. So I just kind of eased back around and watch for them shed again. But yes. Oh, yeah. Hey, how about this one right here? This is what's left of a 2.1 3-pound white perch that Craig put up there. Reason he put it up there, he's the one who caught it. Okay. But anyway, see the shed? That shed was 5 inches long. That's why you hear a lot about pulling cranks. Oh, I'm sure all of you heard about pulling cranks. That's why white perch will hit them crank bases as fast as they'll hit a jig, fast as they'll hit a little minnow. Big shed, you know, big shed, big shiners. A lot of people don't do nothing but use big shiners. I don't know anything about that. Don't even want to learn about it, but yes, sir.
Do you try to match your jig head with the color of your jigs?
No, I don't. I just use those jigs and use that plain lead head jig 90% of the time, like I said. And I do use a pink head occasionally. That's what I do. But I can tell y'all about them cranks. I don't know if y'all know where the devil hole's at on the river. But the devil hole here, this is way back in the 70s. Her dad and I, again, we were up there fishing that devil hole. And that particular time, I don't know what happened, but we was in the same boat. And we were catching white perch on shiners, cane poles. Well, I always had my bass stuff with me. I always wanted bass fish along the same time. You can't do, it took me years to learn you can't do both at the same time. You gotta do one, you gotta do the other. But anyway, we were fishing along there and I saw a big bunch of shad come up and bust in. I said, oh, get them bass out of the water. Here I go with that paddle. Of course, aggravated him. And I flipped out there, said, oh, I got one. But before I could get that fish in the boat, he said, I got one too. He was that quick. He had his out, and it was white perch. And them white perch, Pete probably remembers me talking about them, them white perch reached from right here to right here. I did not measure those white perch, but I can tell you, right here to right here is over 18 inches. Now, how big those white perch were, we don't know. We didn't measure them. We didn't take pictures. Back then, we didn't care. We ate them. You know, that's all we was interested in. We're talking back in the late 60s and early 70s. That was back when you could, I don't know if y'all remember, Louisiana Fire and Light had a camp on that place up there. And you used to be able to pull in their camp, and they'd let you go in there. Can't do that again anymore.
So what you thought was bass was white perch?
What I thought was bass was white perch schooling. Since that time, I think Pete and I have been in a white perch schooling down at Turkey Creek. They school just like bass. Not all the time, but they'll bust them shed. Well, if y'all, they'll bust them shed. That's okay, Craig, I don't need it. They'll bust them shed just like they will anything else. Sure will.
Sam, what size hook for that 16-ounce jig?
That's a number four hook. Number four hook. I'm not a guru on hooks. I don't claim to be. I don't try to be. If it looks good to me, that's the one I use. And I love a number four hook, whatever I've got right here. And that's what I like. Now on a 32nd ounce jig, in the springtime, I will sometimes go down to that. And I use a smaller hook than that hook. But most of the time, it's a sickle hook. And that's another thing. I hadn't really found a lot of difference in the hook sizes as far as a number four, correct me if I'm wrong, and a number six, a bigger hook? A number two is a bigger hook? Okay, number two. A number two and a number four. If you use a number six or number two hook and use a number four hook on the same jigs, I hadn't found a lot of difference. I don't think them fish pay a lot of attention to that hook sticking out of there or know it. Yes, sir.
I'm doing one right now. The shad are from 10 foot channel. They're from 10 foot almost to the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody's fishing 18 and 20 foot.
Mm-hmm.
And I always stay right at the edge of the break, 20, 22 foot of water. But some of these guys are fishing out in there and catching as many fish as everybody else.
I'm staying at 20 feet. Yeah. I'm not kidding about that. I'm staying at 20 feet in the shed.
Everybody's
yes. You are seeing that.
In the middle of the channel, I'm surprised. I hadn't noticed that before.
Early in the morning, you'll see them fish are up. You'll see fish on top of them shed. If you watch electronics, you'll see some fish on top. And I think that's the white perch. About 12, 12 to 14 feet in that neighborhood, down to 16 sometime, but I catch a lot of fish early at that depth. But I just roll my rig up, I leave it at 20 foot, I don't change it. I just take six turns on it and bring it up to 14 foot.
The point I was trying to make is everybody's fishing right in the shad. It's amazing, the shad start at 10 foot and they're fishing 20 foot and they're going down to 30. They fish right in the middle of the shad, which I do too, but I fish on the edge of the channel.
Yeah.
Fishing near the bottom of the shad.
If you'll watch them shad, where we're talking about, those fish are not, how can I say it? They're not in next to that bank. If you got a bluff here, those shad usually start out away from that bluff. That where I'm talking about bluff, where it breaks off of 15, 16 foot of water down to 20, 22, 24 foot of water. If you'll watch, those shad are usually 4 or 5 foot out there. So if you're fishing down that edge, it's another one of my secrets, and I ain't, you know, but that's just what I think. I stay between the shad and the bank. And those fish are there going out and attacking them fish. I don't know. It may be right, may not be.
A good depth finder, a lot of times you see them darts with them fish are darting out there. But yeah, I never see them at Darbon, but I see them at other lakes.
Yeah, well, mine's a little cheap hummingbird down imaging. I've never really noticed that, but I have talked to people just like yourself that has seen that. But I'd have to have my bifocals on to see that probably.
One body.
Yes, sir, that's okay.
I see a lot of people fishing with just traditional lead head. And I was wondering, I think it should be shiny. When mine get old and ugly, I chunk them.
Do you?
But I just have a habit. I just wonder if you have any thoughts on that.
Well, usually when I chunk mine, I don't pay any attention to the lead part of it. I pay attention to the hook.
Yeah.
If that hook don't prick me or make me say, hey, that's a hook, it's coming off.
Yeah. I'm just wondering because you show this one to Jay, and it's silver, like they have something in it that'll stay silver.
Yeah, that's what do they call that? That's not lead. That's
it's not full of lead. It's
like, yeah, I know it's done. What do you call that?
Tungsten.
Yeah, thank you, Pete. Tungsten, I think. You see, I'm going to, a lot of the weights are going to that tungsten. Okay, guys. Hey, look, what we got right here is I appreciate y'all coming out first. Let me reemphasize that. I really do. Now, I don't know if y'all have enjoyed this or if you got anything out of it, but and if you're even interested in doing another one, on my website, I talk about doing four of these a year, a winter, a spring, a summer, and a fall. I love them all. I guess if I had to choose two of them, it'd be hard to choose. I love deep water fishing. It's just one of my passions. I guess I worked in a paper mill too many years and I'd always take my vacation in the wintertime, so I done more wintertime fishing than I did other fishing. Springtime, if you've never done that springtime and run that jig into that cypress tree and felt that thump and tried to have that much line out on one of them poles right there, try to get you enough line out to get him back up there to get him in that land net or lip him. That's another thing, landing nets. I do use landing nets, and I'm getting to come around where I use them more, but I've always mainly lipped my fish or lifted them in the boat. But I done that for one reason. I didn't want people to know I was just catching fish. I'm sorry, that's the way it was. And Pete can tell you that's the way I did it. I used that short rod. Hey, and I can put on one knee right there and reach and get that fish before you can get a landing net under him. But it's fun. But if you're interested, Francis, have you got a sheet back there? A sheet, a sign-up sheet?
When you draw a number, I have their name by the number.
Okay. But what I was talking about was a sign-up sheet. In case any of you... Look, my website, in case you don't know today if you're interested, but my website, not my Facebook now, but my website. You can go to my website, scroll down to the bottom. You've got a place to email me. You've got my telephone numbers on there. I don't mind you calling me. Please call before 9 o'clock at night.
Amen.
I'm an old man. I like to go to bed, but sometimes some of my buddies don't let me. They call me afterwards. That's okay. Hey. But anyway, if y'all are interested in more seminars, or we didn't touch on everything today. We touched on a lot of stuff. But if you're interested in that, maybe later on toward the summer, we can have another one if you're interested in it. If not, whatever. Anyway.
Sam, this is your website here.
This is my website, yes. Hey, notice my little shirt right here. I don't know if you can see it, but got the same thing. It says, catch you later, Crappie, that is. That's my deal. I love it, man. I just love it. Once again, there's cards back there on the table you can pick up, and you can go to my website. You can do anything you want. Right now, we got four little packages right here, and each one of these packages has got one of my favorite jigs I like to use in it. And so if everybody's here, we've got a number 25.
Robert Dawkins. Yes.
Okay.
Well, and I need all the help I
can
get.
Hey, miss. Hey. Thank you, man. I appreciate you coming. That was probably Charles that I just dropped back in. I got two of them out of there. Okay, number 31.
Ron
Thank you, man. Appreciate you coming.
I'm a teacher, I can't
Hi. Here we go. Number. Ain't got a number on it. Number two.
Pete
Leggett. Hey, that's what I'm talking about. Thank you, Pete. Appreciate you, Pete. All right. The last one here. Hey, y'all to be a good one.
Number 21.
James McClellan. All right. There we go, man. Thanks for coming. Appreciate you. Hey, look, guys, I don't know anything else. We got just a second or two more if you got another question or anything that we okay. I've got this one thing that I love in 20 foot of when I'm fishing 20 foot of water, if I'm fishing 18, if I'm fishing 12, or if I'm fishing the flats in 10 or 12 foot of water after the spawn, I've got one pole in this hand. I've got another pole in that other hand, and I'm watching my depth finder, watching the hump, treetops, trash, logs, fish, shed, whatever I'm looking for, whatever I'm seeing, and I'm easing along and I'm watching that my depth finder, making sure I'm staying in the zone. That's the where I'm at. 20 foot of water. Remember a while ago I said that was 18, that was 22. All right, I'm right here in 20 foot of water with my trolling motor, my transducers mounted to my trolling motor. I've got a jig here in 22. I got one over here between 18 and 19. But at that point now, remember it's 20 foot of water. That jig is not, I ain't got it right down in the water. I got it about a foot off, so I'm actually about 19 feet at the bottom of it. But anyway, I'm easing along and I keep a steady movement in and out. Remember the pendulum I was talking about? In and out. Myself, I think that's what happened. I think if they're holding next to that edge, and like Jack mentioned a while ago, if those shad are out here, they're right in there next to that bluff, hiding on that stump line. And when they get hungry, they're darting out there. They got plenty to eat. There is. Just darn owner's got plenty of shad. But they're seeing this strange looking creature come through here. It looks like a shad to them. And he's by himself, and And remember, you're not holding it steady. It's coming up and it's going down a little bit. It's like a dying shed, they think. So easy meal. Reach out there and grab it. But yes, I'm trying to maintain that same level of water. Anybody else?
What's your decision on whether you're gonna, I that sound like you're a deep water fisherman. What's your decision? Am I gonna fish today or shallow tomorrow or what?
Well, in wintertime, I'm a deep water fisherman. Wintertime. In the springtime, I'm a shallow water. Now, I'm a shallow water fisherman, but I'll still go deep. Even when the fish are on trees, there's two guys over here that can tell you that I know because I fish with them. Even when they're on trees, sometimes you can ease out there in that deep water channel fishing and catch them out there too. So they're gonna stay in. Thanks, bud, for coming. And but they're gonna do that. That answer your question?
On your electronics, next time you go to Garbone, you get on that edge of that channel and you don't see any chatter fish, how far do you go before you leave it?
Well, that's a good question. I don't know. I hadn't run into that problem much. Where I fish, when I decide I'm going to fish above 33 Bridge, 33 Bridge being the one coming from Ruston Farm, if I decide I'm going to fish from that bridge, I fish from there all the way, and then again to the Forks. You know where Forks Ferry is at? I fish to there. Then I make my decision as to whether I'm going to go Corny or Darbone. This year, I hadn't been in Darbone but one time. I went up to Darbone arm one time. Done real well. I don't know why I hadn't been back. Probably because of the wind. Hey, look, guys, one other thing, too. Like I said, if you get on my Facebook page, and you can send me a private message if you want to, ask me any question on that. You can go to my website, send me an email anytime you want to. My phone number is also on there. I don't mind you calling me. If you see me up on the lake, hey, wave at me, yell at me, whatever. And if you're interested in another seminar, especially let me know that.
Sam, if you look at your website, are you letting people know, like I caught them this week, 15 foot deep?
Yeah, well, I do that on Facebook. I've got to be tied with Facebook because my guru back there told me that's how I need to do it. Because I wasn't smart enough to post on my website, which is true. You know? Hey, I can post on Facebook fairly easy. So I don't want any comment out there.
You don't have to have a Facebook account to see it.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Thank you, y'all. So good point. You don't have to. You can go to Facebook and look at my site or look at my Facebook page.
Just go to the website, just go to that little Facebook icon.
Okay. So if you click it on, it'll open up. You don't have to have a Facebook account. You can just go to it from there. That's the way Craig set it up. And, hey, that's just the way it is, you know. Don't ask me why. I ask him.
Every day you fish, you'll post a report. He'll tell you most of what it is.
If I see you on Lake Dogbone, I'm not catching fish, and you are, would you give me a laugh?
I tell you what, I've had several people in here. Scooter's fish with me in his boat. Hey, I don't mind people coming. Now, people I don't know, but if you'll just approach me that way, yeah, great. But I don't like people banging into my boat. No, I don't. But welcome to Darbone. You know, hey, but it does happen, you know, but fishing right beside me, I don't mind it at all. Hey, look, I was fishing a tournament here a while back. Mr. Robert over here was fishing up there. He come over and tied onto my boat. We had about a 45-minute conversation. I didn't quit catching white perch. We just talked, and I don't mind that a bit in the world. It don't bother me to talk and fish at the same time.
And he was catching them.
You were.
But, hey, look, guys, I'll admit, there's thousands of guys, hundreds of guys. There's a couple of them sitting in here that's a whole lot better than I am. You know, but I'm lucky. The Lord bless me. I thank him for it every day. You know, and I just, I can't say I can't praise his name enough, you know. And I love to catch white perch. I love it. I can't say it, I love it. My wife told me the other day, said, you know, it's okay as long as we don't make an obsession. I don't know if I have or not, but, you know. No, I'm married to probably the best woman I could be married to as far as fishing. She has never one time. Now, she turns her lip up every now and then about if I say I'm going fishing. And I know when she don't want me to go. Don't mean I don't go. I just said I know when she don't want me to go. But usually I'll try to come home early, 3:30, 4 o'clock. But no. Anything else, guys? Thank y'all again for coming. Hey, look, I do appreciate y'all.
Thank you all.